Thank you for tuning in to The Way, a program brought to you by Southwest Arkansas Churches of Christ. Now join us as we study about Jesus, who is the Way. And now here is your moderator.
Welcome to The Way. The Lord loves you and is interested in your soul. He is interested in your whole life, what you do, but also what you think, what your intents and motives in your heart are. He's interested in everything about your thoughts, your words, and your deeds. He looks, our Lord in the New Covenant, the New Testament, goes beyond outward acts. They're important. We must obey and have the proper outward deeds. But inside of us, there must be right also. As the Lord told Samuel in 1 Samuel 16:7, when he went over there, Samuel went over to pick a king to take Saul's place. God sent him to Jesse. Pick a king, a future king from one of his sons. The first son, Eliab, came in and Samuel thought he must be the one. But the Lord said to Samuel, look not on his countenance or the height of his stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord seeth not as man seeth, for man looketh on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart of man. You see, God knew the heart of these boys, and the best boy was the eighth boy. He looked at seven, I believe it was, in 1 Samuel 16. Neither one of them fit the bill for God. The youngest boy, David, out there keeping the sheep, the shepherd boy, had the most righteous heart and the most righteous character. And he's the one that God had Samuel to anoint to be the king to take Saul's place. The Lord does not look at the outward appearance. He looks at what's inside our heart, what we are down deep in our souls. We're going to be studying about that today in the Sermon on the Mount. I'm Gene Jester, preaching Southwest Arkansas, and Nathan, Saratoga Southside, and McCaskill, I teach there. Brother Robert, you tell us who you are and where you preach.
Robert Cheatham. I preach here in Hope at the North Walker Street Church. Been there since 1977.
Before we go into our study, beginning the Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5 today, I want to ask Brother Robert if he would lead us in prayer.
Our God and our eternal Father in heaven, how excellent is thy name in all the earth. We are so very thankful, Father, for thee and for all that thou have done for us. Worthy art thou of all of our worship, our service, our love, and our adoration. May we realize that we only have one life to live, one life to live. May we, Father, live it to the best of our ability. For that is the only one that thou will receive or accept. We thank thee, Father, for the church of our Lord, which he built, bought, and purchased with his own blood. We are thankful, Father, to have the wonderful opportunity to be a part of that wonderful spiritual body. May we so live as to adorn, to beautify, to make attractive the gospel of Jesus Christ. Forgive us of our sin. Help us to be stronger in thee, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. And Brother Robert, before we begin our study today and before I get into an introduction to it, Matthew 5, let me say something about something I mentioned last week. I told the true story about my father-in-law, Luther Bold, and my son, Tim Jester, when he was as in 1979. He's about 14 years old or so, going fishing. We caught 59 crappie and one bass. I forgot to say, Robert, I think, those crappie averaged a pound apiece. Man, wonderful fishing. Okay, on to the subject today. You know, I thought about here in this passage here in Matthew 4, Christ chose Peter, James, and John, who were fishermen by trade, and Andrew, to be fishers of men. And so we're out here trying to help souls, like they were trying to catch men for Jesus. And that's what we want to do. We want people to be Christians and live a faithful Christian life. And truly, these Beatitudes, to me, the most beautiful sermon I've ever read. The most beautiful sermon. Jesus Christ himself preached it in his ministry. It goes not just to our outward deeds, which are also important. We will give an account for our actual outward acts. But it goes deep into our heart also. What we're thinking, what we're planning, what our motives are, how we feel about things. As Brother Jedd McGarvey said, while spoken to all, the reason the sermon was addressed to the disciples, those who were learners from the leader, Jesus, revealing to them the nature of the kingdom and contrasting it with, one, popular expectation, 2, the Mosaic system, and 3, Pharisaic hypocrisy. Yes, I think Brother McGarvey's got something there that's right. Mr. Haley said about this sermon, the Sermon on the Mount is to the Christian system what the Ten Commandments were to the Law of Moses. Christ in this sermon, for example, will condemn adultery or murder. They're still wrong in the New Law, very much so. Many other scriptures in the New Testament condemn them also. But he goes beyond the killing to the attitude in the heart, too. He goes beyond the adultery to the thoughts in the mind and heart. We'll be judged by all of that on the New Law. The Law of Christ is not easier, is it, Robert?
Nope.
It's not easier than the old law. We just have the Savior on that cross to make possible forgiveness of sins. We can look and we can see there He is by faith, by what it says in the Bible. Remission can be found. We can repent and correct our sins if we'll come to Jesus. Now, in this Sermon on the Mount, Matthew 5, 6, and 7, Brother Shearer and Brother Johnson say it's probably the same one as Luke 6. Brother McGarvey said not necessarily so, because Christ would repeat these same truths many times in His ministry. You know, Brother Johnson says in Luke 6, Jesus spent all night in prayer to God before the next day He chose, He ordained His 12 apostles, and then He goes up to this mount, often called, I think, the Horns of Hattin, probably thought to be the place where He, 7 miles south of Capernaum, where He gave this great sermon, and He was set. It was a custom for teachers in that day to sit and teach, like Robert and I are doing at this table right now. But teaching can be done sitting, standing, and, you know, more than one way, can it? This most beautiful sermon ever preached to me. It says, seeing the multitudes, He went up to a mountain, and when He was set, His disciples came unto Him, and He opened His mouth and taught them, saying. His disciples, a disciple is a learner from a teacher, but we also follow that leader. Christ is our leader and our teacher. We learn from the leader. We follow Him as we learn what He's taught in His book. The disciples then were called Christians first at Antioch, weren't they, Brother Robert? Acts 11, 26. Now, in this great sermon, Christ is going to start it off with 9 Beatitudes, verse 3 through 12. As Brother McGarvey points out, the first 7 of which describe a condition of heart, a condition of soul, a character quality, which by those possessed or those possessing those qualities is promised a reward. The character quality is followed by a reward. But the idea of a blessing being pronounced upon us for having this character quality so we can then be blessed with this reward, they all start out with blessed. I'll go over blessed are the poor in spirit, verse 3, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Brother Robert then will take verse 4 through 7 in a minute and go over 4 more of those Beatitudes. But let me say a Beatitude is more than just the word happy. As some people say, it means happy. Well, it does, but it also means a lot more. It means an approval by God. It means a condition. It means something that's bestowed by God upon man. A blessing bestowed by God. It's special. God is so happily approving if we have this kind of heart condition. And then we'll have rewards for it. Blessed, more than happy, approval by God. Blessings of God bestowed upon us. If we're poor in spirit, number one. Well, what would that mean? That'd mean humble, teachable. We'll learn from Jesus Christ's word, His authoritative word. Obey it and become faithful Christians. Brother B.W. Johnson said, the humble is contrasted to the haughty in this verse. Those sensible of spiritual destitution. Wayne Jackson says, those who consider themselves spiritual paupers are most likely to seek the riches of God's kingdom. Jim Shearer says the poor in spirit means the humble and contrite in heart. This man realizes his own helplessness without the Lord and knows he needs the salvation of Jesus. Brother Jed McGarvey said, those who feel a deep sense of spiritual destitution and comprehend their nothingness before God, the poor in spirit. They're humble, they're teachable. The arrogant are not teachable. If they already know all the answers, they won't be Christians. They won't become a Christian. If they're a Christian and think they know all the answers, they're not a Christian, they're not faithful. They're wrong. The poor in spirit are the humble, the teachable. Like the publican was in Luke 18, who had a contrite heart. I may come back to this if we have time, Robert, and quote that parable, Luke 18, about the publican and the Pharisee going to the temple to pray, but I want to turn over to a verse or two on having an humble and a contrite heart. Start out in Psalms 34, and a verse there says, "The Lord is nigh to them that have a broken heart, and saveth such as be of a contrite spirit." Psalms 51:17. Turn there and read with me if you'd like. Says, "The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and a contrite heart. O God, thou wilt not despise." 57:15. He says, I'm wrong there. I'm going to move on. That's not the right verse. Go to Isaiah 66:2. One of the prettiest to me of all about having a contrite heart. Isaiah 66:1-2. I'm going to let Brother Robert have it and get those next four Beatitudes in. If I get over to Isaiah 66:1-2. "Thus saith the Lord, the heaven is my throne and the earth is my footstool." Think about what a big God we have. He created all this. "Where is the house that you build me? And where is the place of my rest? For all those things my hand has made, and all those things have been, says the Lord. But to this man will I look." He said, "I'll take notice of this kind of man. Even though I was powerful enough to build the whole heaven and earth and make it all, I'm so big, God's so big and powerful, He can sit on the earth as His, use it for His footstool, and the heaven as His throne." He said, "To this man will I look, even to him that is of a poor and contrite spirit and trembleth at my word." Friends, do you have an humble, contrite heart when you sin? Do you want to please Christ? Do you come in repentance? Do you? Will you? Do you tremble at the word of God, or do you just pay no attention to it, like many despise it, pass it off with a joke or a smirk? Friends, this is God talking to you. You're going to be judged by this book. I'm going to be judged by this book. Don't take it lightly. It's the most serious thing you ever picked up. Read God's holy, inspired, inerrant word. You'll be judged by it. God loves an contrite spirit. Brother Robert.
"Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. These are the ones who in the suit of their recognized need of God." The Bible says that God is the Father of all mercies and the God of all comfort, who comfort us in our tribulation. In 2 Corinthians 1:3, the Bible said that if we will live godly in Christ Jesus, we will suffer persecution. 2 Timothy 3:12. A lot of folks said that they were glad that Jesus was not Jeremiah, because Jeremiah was designated as the weeping prophet. They failed to realize that Jesus was also a weeping man. He wept at Lazarus' tomb in John 11:35. He wept over a city, according to Luke 19:41, Luke 13:37, verse 5. "Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth." Jesus was meek and Jesus was lowly, according to Matthew 11:28-29. Often misunderstood, meekness is not at all weakness, but rather a noble quality, a noble attribute, which might be described as power under control, or strength made tender. Love for God, truth, and man is productive of meekness. The meek are humble in response to God's will, in response to man's treatment, in respond to life adversities. Verse 6, "Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled." The Bible informs us that we are to grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, 2 Peter 3:18. And we are to desire the sincere milk of the word, 1 Peter 2:2. "As the powerful and relentless physical drive of hunger and thirst compels one to seek food and water, the compelling desire to please God by conforming to His standard for righteousness drives those who know and are properly grateful for God's love." Psalm 119:172. Romans 1, 16 and 17. The only means of expressing that love for their Creator is in pursuit of that righteousness, that is, by their faith working through love. 1 John 4:19, 1 John 5:3, Galatians 5:6, John 14, the verse there is number 15. Verse 7, blessed are the merciful, for they shall obtain mercy. What is mercy? Mercy is kindness. Mercy is tenderness. Mercy is more than pity. It is actively compassionate. Mercy prevents one's pursuit of righteousness from becoming self-righteous. God extended a mercy to man is a manifestation of his love. Men who love souls will extend mercy to their fellow man.
Hey, Brother Robert, merciful, help for the helpless, pardon for those who deserve to be punished. You know, forgiving. God's a forgiving God. We'll obey Him. If we'll be contrite and fall down before Him. In fact, Christ taught us in Matthew 6:12 in the prayer, didn't He? The model prayer. Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. In verse 14 and 15 of that Matthew 6, He said, forgive men of their trespasses, your Heavenly Father will forgive you of your trespasses. If you forgive not men their trespasses, your Heavenly Father will not forgive your trespasses. And you know, James, as Brother B.W. Johnson said, ready to forgive, and Wayne Jackson said, people who show mercy to others will reap in kind. We're saved by the mercy of God, Titus 3:5 says, aren't we, Robert? In James 2:13, James wrote, he shall have judgment without mercy, who has showed no mercy. And mercy rejoiceth against judgment. When the judgment day comes, if you and I have been merciful to other people, God will be merciful to us. Mercy rejoices against judgment. We have nothing to fear in that area if we have been forgiving and merciful. If we've tried to help the helpless, to help the needy, to help the sinner come on up and out of sin. Like that poor woman in Luke 7 that kissed Jesus' feet, wiped them with the hairs of her head, anointed his feet with ointment. The sinner, the woman that Simon the arrogant Pharisee called a sinner. He was a sinner too and didn't know it. And she wanted the forgiveness of Christ. She loved much. She had a great faith. God, Christ forgave her. Blessed are the merciful. You know, these are great Beatitudes you just read, Robert. I mean, all of them, every one of these are great. The whole sermon is unbelievably beautiful and powerful as it gets deep into the heart and soul of man. You talked about mourning. Blessed are they that mourn, for they shall be comforted. I think mourning is going to be those who experience godly sorrow. 2 Corinthians 17, that leads to repentance, not to be regretted. And after David had sinned with Bathsheba, and after David had Uriah killed, he committed a cluster of sins there, and he became so sorry. He begged God's forgiveness when Nathan made him realize that he was the guilty man. And in Psalms 51, Psalms 32, he writes about prayer, penitential psalms. And he asked God, he begs God, have mercy on me, O God, according to your loving kindness, according to the multitude of your tender mercies. Blot out my transgressions. Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin. Verse 8, make me to hear joy and gladness. You see, he was sad now. He was upset because he realized he had done so wrong. That the bones which thou hast broken may rejoice. He experienced spiritual mourning, godly sorrow for his sins. Hide thy face from my sins and blot out all my iniquities. Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit in me. Cast me not away from thy presence and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. Uphold me with thy free spirit. Then will I teach, if you'll just let me be saved again, God, if you'll accept me back. This is King David talking, friends. The penitent man after God's own heart who had sinned. Restore to me the joy of thy salvation, the man who's mourning spiritually. Then will I teach transgressors thy ways, and sinners shall be converted to thee. I'm going to get back to doing what I've done, God, before I'm going to teach people your word, if you'll just forgive me and save me and make me happy and know the joy of my salvation again. And he did. Nathan said, you are forgiven. Blessed are they that mourn. You see, we could spend a great deal of time on all these, couldn't we, Brother Robert? Every one of them are beautiful. meek shall inherit the earth. Brother B.W. Johnson still has the best comment on that I've ever read. He says the word inherit the earth here means, of course, meek is strength under control, as you pointed out, gentleness and kindness. Inherit the land. Inherit the earth. Johnson says the land is the word there. It means the land, which is a type of Canaan, and Canaan is a type of heaven. You're going to have heaven as your abode if you'll live for the Lord and have a controlled spirit, meek in heart. Being forgiven by God, as Brother McGarvey said, shall inherit the earth, Jesus says, meaning heaven. Beautiful, beautiful verses of truth and hope and blessedness for those who will have such character qualities inside. Brother Roberts, you read that Hungering and Thirsting After Righteousness, didn't you? Mm-hmm. Do you think that means they want to do right, live right, be right with God?
Yep, and the Word of God is the avenue in which to make it happen.
And the only avenue, right? In fact, too, Psalms 119, 172 says all thy commandments are
righteousness.
So if you learn God's commandments, you learn. A man who's hungry and thirsting after righteousness, and I believe there's some people out in this old world right now, listening to me and Robert, who really want to know what God wants them to do to be Christians and be saved, and be faithful. You want to live forever. You want to go to heaven. You're a priesty for God and Jesus Christ dying for you on that cross. You're a priesty if you came and left heaven, where it's all perfect and wonderful, and came out of this world's sorrow and sin. You're thankful for it. God will help you if you really want to know now. Read his book, but believe what it says and obey, do what it says. Don't argue with it. Okay? These next ones, I'm going to read, Brother Robert, if you want to comment. Next Beatitudes, number 6 through 9. The first 7 are soul conditions of character followed by reward. The last 2 are outward circumstances. If we endure properly, we'll have a reward. These last 2, verse 9 through, verse 11, 10 through 12. Okay. Verse 8. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Blessed are they that were persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Outward circumstances. The first 7 inner conditions of heart. Verse 11 and 12, blessed are you when men shall revile you and persecute you and say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven, for so persecuted they the prophets which were before you. Brother Robert, would you like to comment on those Beatitudes number 6 through 9?
Blessed are the pure in heart. The word blessed means happy or fortunate, for they shall see God. To be pure in heart is to be purified, clean, free from sin, sanctified and holy. Jesus says, now you are clean through the word I have spoken to you, John 15, verse number 3. We purify our souls through obedience to the word of God, 1 Peter 1:22. The writer of Hebrews says, seek peace with all people and holiness without which no one shall see the Lord, Hebrews 12, verse 14. The pure in heart shall see God. God makes us holy, clean, sanctified at the point he forgives and saves. 1 Corinthians 6:11, verse 9, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Peacemakers are to be called the children of God. Those who call division are to be rejected. After the second admonition, Titus 3, verse 10, Jesus wants us to be peacemakers. Being a peacemaker only does not make one a child of God. Obeying the gospel of Jesus Christ make one a child of God. Verse 10, blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Those who are persecuted, mistreated, abused, and displaced, are ridiculed because of righteousness, are blessed with blessed with this happy condition. The kingdom of heaven, which is theirs, as a result of faithfully enduring such persecution, is the church that Jesus built his kingdom, according to Matthew 16, 18, and 19. We are transported into it, Colossians 1, 13. This kingdom cannot be moved, Hebrews 12, 28. This kingdom cannot be destroyed, Daniel 2:44, Daniel 7:13 and 14. if we are persecuted for contending for the faith, once for all delivered to the saint, the Lord blesses all with us. Jude 3. If anyone suffer, he should suffer as a Christian, as a child of God, as a follower of Christ. 1 Peter 4, verse 16. Notice that the Lord is not saying that everyone that is persecuted will be blessed. It must be for righteousness' sake. According to 2 Timothy 3:12, the eternal reward awaits the faithful child of God. We must be faithful, according to Revelation chapter 2, verse 10. The Bible said that it is required of stewards that they be found faithful, according to 1 Corinthians chapter 4. The verse there is number 2.
So great, Robert. How wonderful these verses are. Tremendous, tremendous passages to live our lives by, aren't they?
Yes, they are.
Blessed are the merciful. Blessed are the meek. Verse 5. For they shall inherit the earth, as Brother Johnson said, B.W. Johnson says, Canaan was a type of heaven, inherit the earth. And concerning the peacemakers, Brother Johnson says, not the soldiers of a warrior king, but men who practice and teach peace and goodwill among men. As the angels sang in Luke 2:14, glory to God in the highest, on earth peace and goodwill toward men. Says they praise God with the heavenly host. You know, I really think it's a song that the angels sang there concerning Jesus being born in Bethlehem in that barn and laid in that little feed trough, that manger. No room for him in the inn. They didn't have room for Mary and Joseph and the Son of God to be born. Born in poverty, raised in obscurity. But the divine Savior has more influence in the world today than anybody who's ever lived or ever will live. You know in Isaiah 2, peacemakers, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. Isaiah 2, 4, after Christ had prophesied he's going to build his church, his house, his kingdom, his family, he said, he shall, after he talked about the word of the Lord coming from Jerusalem and the law of Christ from Mount Zion, then he said, he shall judge among the nations, shall rebuke many people, and they shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Won't be like Israel anymore. Get your gun and go get them. Nations shall not lift up sword against nation, neither shall they learn war anymore. The Church of Christ is to be a peaceable, practicing peace people. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. As Johnson said, not the soldiers of a warrior king, but men who practice and teach peace and goodwill among men. Christ said in John 14, our time's up, and I had a whole lot else I want to say, Robert. Excuse me, but we'll come back next week, Lord willing. It's been a joy to study these wonderful Beatitudes with you. God loves you. Try this way of life, friends. No one else can provide what the Lord here tells you about. It works. It's wonderful. Robert and I know. Tune in next week, same time.